Before we jump into and talk about the actual process of burning waste itself, which is very exciting, let's talk about the waste a little bit more. So this is kind of a flashback to our very first chapter talking about waste characterization. And there are a couple units that are really important for understanding the amount of energy that we're going to be able to extract from our waste in a thermal treatment process. And those are our heating values. So we've got our higher heating value and our lower heating value. When I first introduced this concept, I used the example of a grape and a raisin. They both have the same organic stuff in them. It's just the raisin has very little moisture and the grape is full of water. So they would both have the same higher heating value, that gross calorific value that's just measuring the amount of energy. Whereas obviously the raisin would be easier to burn than the grape, which is full of water. So the grape's lower heating value is gonna be much worse than the raisin's. Because we're now factoring in that water. And that's also called the net calorific value. So after we deal with that water, how much do we have left over? So these are both important to know for designing a incinerator. Typically, the lower heating value is the more conservative assumption. If you're able to recover some of the heat that's in the water vaporized, then you can actually pull some of the energy closer to the higher heating value. But generally, you do want to have drier waste going into these systems because it will have a better, a lower heating value. It's higher, closer to the higher heating value. A typical heating value for waste is around 10,000 kilojoules per kilogram. And that is about the same as raw ground beef. So if you think of raw ground beef being marketed, especially in Canada, it's like something for big, strong, healthy people. You can think of waste as something for big, strong, healthy thermal treatment plants. There's a lot of energy in that waste, just as valuable to a thermal treatment plant as a hamburger would be to us. Incinerators typically handle around on the order of 45 tons of waste a day. That's kind of an economical scale, which would produce about a megawatt of energy, which is around 10% of an average size city's electricity demand. So if you think of, you know, the total material and energy flows going through an average city, it's a good chunk of it could be handled by just the energy that's contained in that city's waste. And obviously this varies a lot with the materials, and based on their proportions in the mix, it's going to dictate the net characteristics of the mix. But just to show you some values for different materials, paper and plastic are some of the best materials, the highest value, but those are also both recyclable materials. So they really shouldn't be ideally going into incinerators. As we saw in the US EPA data, the greenhouse gas benefits of recycling them are much better than thermally treating them, even though we're going to get a lot of energy out of them. Then we've got things like rubber and leather and textiles, and these are things that we can't really recycle that easily. So they're actually good choices to send to incineration versus a landfill. Then we've got, getting closer to the bottom, things like food and yard waste, and that's a lot to do with the moisture that's contained in them. But those are both things that really shouldn't be ending up in this stream. They should be in our organic waste treatment processes. And then any inorganic stuff, metal, glass, ceramics, is just dead weight in our incinerator. It's just taking up space and producing ash at the end without producing any energy. So all that stuff ideally would also be diverted to recycling programs. It's not going to help out our thermal treatment plant. So you might be saying to yourself, well, heating values sound great. I'm happy there's a lot of energy in waste, but how do you actually determine the heating value of something? And there's a bunch of methods we can use. I've arranged them in the table on screen here, from the most direct, accurate way to measure it down to progressively more lower accuracy approximations on our way down based on what information we have available. So at the top, the best thing you can do is to directly measure the heat that's actually released by actually burning it in conditions similar to your thermal treatment reactor. So you can do that in a device called a calorimeter, very similar to the way that calories are measured for food. We can measure the calories in waste, and that's just really directly measuring it and letting us know how much energy is recoverable. Now, if you don't have a calorimeter, you've just got some data. The best data you can work with is the ultimate analysis. So the ultimate analysis, if you recall from our very first unit, is kind of the actual mass fractions of the different elements in our waste. So we know that carbon, you know, is going to oxidize into CO2, hydrogen is going to turn into water, et cetera, et cetera. So that gives us an idea of how much energy do we actually get from oxidizing each of these elements. And you can use an empirical equation like the one shown here to figure out what heating value we could expect from those types of materials. You can also just use the enthalpy of formation formulas and do it in a similar way, and you'll get a similar answer. Now, if you don't know the exact proportions of all the elements in our ultimate analysis, you just have the proximate analysis. So again, that was the comparison of our volatile, fixed, and ash fractions. Then that can also be used. So the volatile and fixed fractions will both burn. The fixed fraction has higher caloric value because it's those bigger molecules that don't just puff off right away like the volatile matter. The volatile matter contributes, but they're kind of smaller molecules and less energy dense. So that gets accounted in that formula. And then if you haven't done any lab tests at all, but you can just look at the waste and kind of see what are the proportions of different materials, maybe you have some waste audit data, you can also use an empirical formula that takes to account what are the proportions of different types of waste within the mixed waste that's going into the thermal treatment. So if you look at some of the coefficients in the formula here, our highest one is for plastics, and then we've got paper, and then we've got a negative one on water and a really small one on food waste, which is mostly water. And that reflects exactly what we were looking at with these values. So you can use any of these to approximate the heating value of a waste, but you should always choose the one that's higher up on the list. It'll be more accurate. And I'll show you an example that proves this. So if, say, you're an incinerator operator, you get a load of shredded paper in and you want to adjust your process to properly account for the amount of heat that it is going to produce. Your calorimeter is broken, so you're going to use the information you have. So you know it's paper, it's mostly cellulose, and you know the formula for that. You also have some proximate analysis data. And then you have your menu of ways to try and calculate what can this be. So how do these methods stack up based on the example we have here? So if you start with first principles and you look at the enthalpy of formation, we know the enthalpy of the reaction is the enthalpy of the products minus the reactants, and you can go in. We've got CO2, six of them multiplied by the enthalpy for CO2, five waters, we've got the water enthalpy, and then subtracting our reagents, we've got our one cellulose, and then our six oxygens, we get minus 2,607 kilojoules per mole. We use the molar mass to change it from a molar basis to a mass basis, and we get about 16,000 kilojoules per kilogram. So that's the hard way to do it. We do all the math and look up the tables. We can use that same information of the chemical composition of the cellulose to use the ultimate analysis formula. This is our second one on the table. And we get an answer that's about the same. So we got 16 doing it the hard way, we got 15 doing it the little bit easier way. So that's still pretty accurate. And then if we go back and use these fixed carbon and volatile matter numbers, we get 19. So now we're three off, this one we were one off, so we're getting further away from the answer. And then the last thing we can do is, we know it's all paper, so we can go back to our very last formula on the table, this one, and just plug everything in on the paper fraction, and the answer we get is 12, almost 13,000. So now we're getting further and further away as we go down the table. So that's why it's always better to use the highest amount of information you use, but these are all, they're all in the neighborhood, right? And I'll give you a question on this week's quiz to practice some of these formulas, and you'll see which ones work out best firsthand.